Croesus from the historic ancient kingdom of Lydia has minted the world's first coin, and you as a trader slash merchant are trying to obtain these. And you're going to do so by bartering with merchants, obtaining property, and then if you can, you're going to try and develop those properties as you move along the game of Lions of Lydia. And in the game, it's going to be a bag pulling game. So you're going to be pulling meeples out of a bag and placing those meeples down on the appropriate area or gate and gaining those resources, which will allow you to, of course, gather properties and develop those properties and hopefully maintaining some control over the currency that is the coin that Croesus has made. You play up to 2 to 4 players, takes about 30 to 60 minutes to play, and is for ages 12 and up by Bellwether Games. The game's art and illustration is by Daryl T. Jones, and the design is Johnny Pack. Let's go ahead and take a look at the game down below. I'll show you how to play, maybe a round or so, and then we'll come up and I'll discuss the game. Welcome to the ancient kingdom of Lydia and the game Lions of Lydia, set up for 4 players. And it plays 2, 3, or 4, and the setup is the same, except when you're playing a 2-player game, you'll have one less of these bronze or silver cards here at the bottom. Now, to begin the game, every single player is going to get a player board. They're going to get the colored tokens that associate to these token symbols here, and they're going to place them on the appropriate spaces, along with this one as well. It looks like a little pillar. Every single player is also going to get a starting card. These are the development cards, and they're going to have a little banner in the top left-hand side, and just go ahead and place them down next to your board, as well as a bag. And inside your bag, you're going to be getting meeples, one of each of the 4 different colors, red, green, blue, and yellow, regardless of the number of players. Additionally, you're going to then set up the main board of the game and all of the building and development cards on each side of the board. Go ahead and take one random gold card and place it anywhere on this area here in each of the 4 spaces, as well as 2 purple, and then in a 3 and 4 player game, have 3 of these silver cards, and then a 2-player game, you'll just have 2 of them. Additionally, you're going to have gates, and you're going to place those gates based on the color edge of the board. So the red gate will go over here, the yellow will go here, and so on and so forth. Then, randomly assign a color that is different to the gates in each of the gate areas. So never add green with green, and never add red with red in these areas to begin the game with. And then one of each of the 4 different meeples inside the center of the fountain space. This is the main plaza of the game. Go ahead and place this token here. This is the final token, which will basically ensure the end of the game when somebody reaches the number of development cards they need to end the game. They'll also take this, which will give them points for each of the coins they manage to keep along the game. Then you'll have to just place this little gold meeple here on the 5 space for each player board, as well as on each of the gold cards here. That is the entire setup, other than just go ahead and set up the side area over here for coins, as you'll gather them throughout the game. To begin the game, select a starting player and go ahead and let them start with the 3 actions on your turn that you'll be doing. The first step is always to draw a random merchant from your bag. And this is the bag here. You're going to simply draw one of the 4 meeple colors and pull it out. From there, you're going to place this merchant onto one of the 4 spaces on the outside called the gates, or at the center where the fountain is. Now, if you place your meeple at one of the gates here, you're going to gain resources on your player board based on the colors associated inside of that specific area. And if you place it in the middle here, you'll be able to buy and develop cards either in front of you or in a certain portion of the game board. From there, you're then going to go ahead and push any merchants of the same color in an area back to the center of the board and grab any meeple or worker from the middle of the board and put it back into your bag. And play will continue as follows. So let me go ahead and show you a basic turn of play. I'll go ahead and let's use this guy over here. I'll pull a meeple out of the bag. I'll take this. Okay, I've got a yellow. I'll go ahead and place it here at this yellow gate. That's going to give me 1 and 2 yellow resources and 1 green resource. Resources are very useful because you'll be able to buy cards whenever you place your worker in the middle area where the fountain is. And you can buy as many cards in one specific area as you possibly can afford. And the cards are going to cost things like coins, it's going to cost resources, as well as a wild resource of your choice, and sometimes a combination of both. Additionally, you will be able to actually take cards like this and develop them for the same cost you would to buy them. When also you're placing your meeple down in this area here, you're going to gain bonus resources depending on the cards that you have developed and or bought throughout the game next to your player board. If you get a blue meeple and you place it at a blue gate, you'll gain a blue resource. It's very, very simplistic in nature. Some other cards will say stuff like, at the end of the game, you're going to gain one bonus point for every red resource you have remaining, or for each card that you have in front of you, or something like, for each equal meeple inside your bag, you'll gain three bonus victories. Points. When your resource track moves across the board and hits that six area, that's going to be really nice because you can trigger one of two effects. You can either A, develop a card for free, or B, you can move this track down and gain the benefits. Now, the reason why you'd want to move this track down is because as you move it down, you're going to go from 3 to 5 to 8 to as many as you'd like, cards placed in front of you that you can then use to develop. But right now you can only have 3 cards next to you. In the first space, you'll get this little gold meeple and place it in the middle of the board here. In the next space here, you're going to get 2 coins, 3 coins, 4 plus 4 victory points, 5 plus 10 victory points, and then finally at the very end here, that is going to give you 18 victory points, and blue will count as any color as far as resources go. Very, very useful. These are not cumulative, it's just the highest one you get at the end of the game will give you the most points possible that is available to you. So, as you move the board up here, you'll be using these resources as well. When you put your cards, you put your meeples down here, your workers in here, you'll select an area. Let's go ahead and say that this guy had something like this. Then he's going to be able to choose cards to buy. So, for instance, he says, oh, okay, maybe I want to buy this one here. It'll cost 1 yellow, it'll cost 1 red, and it'll cost 1 wild. Yellow, red, and a wild. I'll take this card, place it here. And specifically with this card here, whenever you buy a card with a golden meeple, you'll place that golden meeple in the middle of the board here. Now, a couple little caveats throughout the game. If you have a golden meeple on a certain area on the board, and for instance, you're pulling out, I don't know, a worker of that color, or any color, placing it on that area, you're going to score resources just like you normally would, ignoring that worker. You'd score 2 blue, 1 2, and you'd score 1 yellow. However, if you'd like, you can turn that gold worker into a currency worker, and you can, instead of gaining that 2 blue resources, you can take 2 coins. Coins are wild resources, you can use them to buy and develop things, as well as at the end of the game, if you have this little perfect beauty here, you're going to score additional victory points, and potentially even more victory points if there's a purple card in your area that will let you score points as well. These coins are very nice, and they help you make it very, very easy for you to acquire cards you might not be able to, specifically these purple ones, which always only require coins. And that's pretty much the idea of the game. Players are going to be placing on these little ends here to gather resources. Players are going to place there in the middle to gather cards as well as to upgrade slash develop their cards. And then when 6, 7, or 8 cards are developed by a single player, depending on the number of players, the game is going to trigger the end. Players are going to tally up their points based on this track here, these points here, whether they have this or not. And of course, the bonus points for the purples, and whoever has the most is going to win the game Lions of Lydia. Hopefully it was enough of an explanation. Let's come up and talk about it. So let's discuss coin minting in the game Lions of Lydia as we gather our workers, placing them in certain areas on the board, gathering the cards and developing them, and creating a beautiful little society in which you make the most money. That's the most important thing in this game, is gathering as much money and victory points as possible. And of course, if you end the game, you're definitely going to want to have as many coins as you can. But of course, ending the game usually means you spent the most resources on gaining the cards and developing them, which means you're less likely going to have as many, which is probably why the main player gets it. Another little thing I want to mention is this game has quite a few mini expansions in it, which I didn't discuss, but along with a lot of Johnny Pack's games, he likes to add a lot of extra mini expansions that can be put into the game. I've played a few of them in the PNP, print and play, and I won't discuss them too much, but I did enjoy them. I think that they work really well with this game, and much to the style of a lot of games I've played of his, it fits very well in this one. This one is actually on the lighter side of a lot of the games I've played in relation to his games, in the fact that it's fairly simple. You're going to be basically pulling a meeple from a bag, placing it on the board, do whatever action it is, and then you're going to take a meeple from the fountain and put it back into your bag. That's all the entire game is, and you go through that, but there's a lot of interesting choice in that. Do you want to build things or do you want to gain resources? And then how do you want to gain resources or where do you want to build? As the game progresses, there are going to be less things available to you to purchase, but there's going to be more meeples on the board. Do you want to start minting coin using those golden meeples, or would you rather stockpile an entire set of green or maybe purple meeples that are going to allow you to utilize your cards, which will give you a strong engine? The game has a bit of a luck factor and you don't know what you're going to pull out, but that is extremely mitigated by the fact that you can make and decide what is in your bag and how you pull. And there's only ever going to be four meeples in your bag. It's just what colors are they going to be and how you're going to utilize them. And that is a very, very powerful tool in this game. This is a prototype, and so because of that, it is not going to be the final look of the game, although it is beautiful and they did a very good job with the prototype. Overall, the quality of the components, the artwork, everything is very nice. I've seen a lot of stuff, Daryl T. Jones, and I am a big fan of his as well. I think he does great artwork, and this is one that stands as well. It's very, very nice. Overall, I enjoyed this game quite a bit. It was a refreshing game that I actually would play more than once in a row, whereas a lot of games that have this type of nature, usually I'm like, okay, that's enough. I need to sit and go ahead and switch it to something else. But with this one, I can actually go ahead and play one more, even two more times if I really wanted to, and I wouldn't feel burnt out. Whereas a lot of the games where you're placing down meeples, it feels like that worker placement, engine building thing, you're like, ooh, that was great, but now I'm tired and I want to relax. But on that side, it is a lighter, so if you want to add more complexity, I strongly suggest taking those extra expansions and putting them in. I'm curious to see what gets tossed in the mix here based on how the Kickstarter does, which is ending either today or tomorrow, depending on when I get this video out, or in the next day. I don't know. I don't know how many days are left in the campaign. Regardless, though, I really, really enjoyed this game. I've liked all of his games, and this one is also very, very, very fun. I gotta talk about some little negatives, I suppose. I'm not the biggest fan of the theme, but it does work in this game. You do feel like you're moving around the board and gathering your merchants, and you're buying and selling and producing certain things and moving. It's not like you're just placing down random colors on a board. It does feel like you're going places, but just the theme itself wasn't the strongest turn-on for me. It's a weird word to use for a board game. A turn-on? Oof, maybe we'll cut it. Maybe we won't. But regardless, though, if you're interested in taking a look at Lions of Lydia, I strongly suggest you do. I had a great time with this one, and this one definitely deserves the fun. It definitely deserves to be a game, and it's one I would keep in my collection. So if that says anything for you, definitely check it out down below. It's on Kickstarter. There's a link in the description. Link here, Michael. Link. And like and subscribe to the channel. All right, guys, that's all I got for you this time. And as always, I look forward to... What am I gonna look forward to? I just gotta figure out what these are. I want to effectively manage the merchants I hire, keeping the best assortment in your bag while leveraging the unique abilities of each when it's drawn next time.